And if that's your idea on an emergency, then you've got much larger issues with your personal finances that you should probably start addressing now. What's up, everyone? Conrad Neufeld here, and today we're talking about what your emergency fund should look like. But before we get into that, I want to thank everyone who has continued to watch my videos, even though I haven't come up with one in the last month and a half. It's been a super busy mortgage market, I've been tied up with that, and yet I still have current subscribers messaging me and emailing me saying, hey, here's another idea for a video, here's questions that I have, and I super appreciate that because I've gotten a lot of good video ideas that I'll be rolling out with to answer some of those questions. This was one of them. So if you have questions or other video ideas, please continue to message me, and if you haven't already subscribed, please hit that subscribe button right now. Okay, let's talk emergency funds. I think most people get the general idea behind an emergency fund. Some bad thing happens, and you have this bucket of money that you can draw from to fix said bad thing, or at least weather out the storm. But I want to get even more specific behind that idea of what an emergency actually looks like, because I think there are a lot of lofty financial plans for emergency funds that will generally fall short when things really get tough. So let's first talk about what can cause an emergency, but more specifically, what does an emergency actually look like? A lot of people, for instance, might say that losing your job constitutes an emergency, particularly if you're a single income household just like myself. I mean, after all, if you lose your income, that can provide a lot of challenges for you. I mean, let's say you just lost your job. You still have rent or a mortgage. You still have utilities and property taxes. I mean, I presume you probably like eating, so you're gonna wanna buy groceries too, and so on. It can feel like you're suffocating from the anxiety that that situation can cause you. And unfortunately, we just went through a pandemic where we saw that level of suffering quite prevalent with a lot of people, hopefully on a level I'll never see again in my lifetime. But here's where I'm going to seemingly fly in the face of common sense and say that losing your job doesn't actually constitute an emergency. Well, it can be, it just shouldn't be. To understand why, here's four things that typically happen during an emergency. Number one, loss of income. Emergencies can obviously have a dramatic impact on your income, particularly if that emergency is partly caused by the loss of your job or from extended sick leave because of some medical event. It's also well known that we as human beings are terrible at planning for the future. I mean, even though we know we're not going to work our current job forever, although I hope in your case it's because of early retirement, we do a terrible job of planning for that day. So when an emergency springs up and reduces our income in some way, it can provide one of the biggest challenges during an already challenging time. We often assume our income will be there until it's not. It's more than that though, because number two, existing debts collect more interest and drain the account. When you've got no income coming in, the big ticket items like your rent or your mortgage payment, your cell phone payments, your utilities, your property taxes, your groceries, the everyday living expenses that you need just to survive can start draining your account fairly fast. But what's worse is when you have debts on top of all of those expenses. Your payments on your debts rarely go away. So when you have things like unsecured lines of credit or credit cards, not only do you have minimum payments that you have to make on those, but they also start accruing interest, compounding your already terrible position. Now, not only are you struggling with your existing payments, but with each passing day, you're getting further and further behind. And on top of that, number three, new debts can show up, like medical bills. So it's not just about having less income, savings dwindling, and all these existing debts accruing further and further interest, but it's all of the new debts that an emergency might bring to the table. Worse than that, number four, some of these things happen at the same time that your emergency fund takes a hit. Let's go back and look at the job loss emergency. Most people know when they suck at their job. Like, there are very few people who, when they're fired, they're thinking, man, I was like one day away from a promotion and I was absolutely slaying it at work. You know what I mean? Like, most people know when they suck at their job, and most people have an indication when they know they're about to be fired. Being laid off, on the other hand, could come as a surprise and often coincides with some kind of industry or market downturn. So when you're laid off, you may end up in a situation where it did genuinely come as a surprise to you, but it's also during a time usually when the market has taken a hit, which is the reason why you were laid off in the first place, meaning most of the investments that you thought you had as a safety net likely also took a hit. And this is why thinking of losing your job as the emergency is the wrong way to think about it. No doubt losing your income can cause a financial emergency. But if that's the case, that losing your job was the thing that caused that, then there were a lot of things going wrong in your financial situation long before you lost your job. And most of those were probably a result of bad planning. So what should you do? Well, it really depends on where you're currently at financially. So let's look at a few options by answering a few questions. Should I pay off debts or save my money for an emergency fund? Meet Kevin, a popular YouTuber out there, talks about paying off debt right away. He says this.
Remember, if you're building an emergency fund while you still have debt, you're guaranteed paying interest to other people, oftentimes in excess of 7 to 12 to 15 to 20%. It's stupid. Why would I guarantee paying interest just for the just-in-case scenario that I need money in case of an emergency? I would rather do the opposite. I'd rather not have an emergency fund, put all of my emergency fund money onto paying off my credit cards. Now I stop the bleeding. Now guaranteed I'm saving that interest money and I have it available in case I need to draw on it again. I can swipe my credit card and get money right back out of it.
Here's where he's right and where I think some of the details need a bit more color so that people don't take away the wrong point here. Debt generally falls into two categories. Revolving debt, so think of a revolving door, you can put money on it, take money off of it, put money on it, and go around and around. These are things like unsecured lines of credit, credit cards, etc. Then you also have installment loans. These are loans that have fixed payments. You start at one lump sum of debt that you need to pay and make consistent payments to pay that down until eventually that debt is no more. These are things like car payments, term loans, mortgages, and on and on. Here's the key part though. Paying off your debts that accrue interest, like the revolving debts, like your credit cards, and paying off your term loans, like your car loans, are two very different stories. Meet Kevin is right. It's stupid to plan for some kind of future emergency while simultaneously bleeding interest on the back end through your debts. If it comes down to paying off your credit cards and your other revolving lines, or saving for an emergency fund, pay down your debts instead. And depending on how substantial those debts are, it may be worth looking at turning those revolving credit cards into something like a consolidation loan where they become a term loan with a fixed payment to try to save on those interest sooner than later. Now, in regards to your installment loans, it may not make a lot of sense to use your emergency fund to make advanced payments against those. And here's why. If I owe $8,000 on my car loan and I make an advanced payment of $400 on it, I'll now owe $7,600 and have saved a bit of interest. But here's the catch. My actual car payment hasn't changed a dime. It's still the same car payment that I had before I made the additional payment, and it stays that way until the entire debt is paid off. So unless you have the ability to remove the debt completely or already have an emergency fund, it does make a lot of sense to instead save that money towards an emergency fund. That way, if an emergency actually does happen, you're gonna have a bucket of money with which to draw from to make the scheduled payments that you've already agreed to. Should my home equity line of credit be my emergency fund? I actually really, really like home equity lines of credit set aside as an emergency fund. Here's why. Number one, in Canada, you can only have a home equity line of credit if you have more than 20% equity in your home, and it can never be worth more than 65% of the overall current value of your home. This means that if you ever get into dire straits, the emergency just gets so bad that you have to liquidate your home, you have to sell your house, that any of the debts that you've accrued on that home equity line of credit also get dissolved with the sale of your house. So barring some catastrophic drop in housing prices, you're likely going to be in a situation where you're going to have at least some equity left over by the time you liquidate your house and those debts associated with that house. As a result, this could reduce the chance that you end up in a situation of bankruptcy or insolvency. The second reason that I really like HELOCs set up as an emergency fund is that you only ever have to make interest-only payment. And not only that, those interest-only payments can be paid using the home equity line of credit, provided that you still have room left available on it. So not only are you required to make lower payments, but if the emergency has put you in a really, really tight spot, you could potentially defer a lot of those payments using the home equity line of credit. And the third reason why I like home equity lines of credit is that it frees up that cash, that emergency fund that you'd otherwise be sitting on for other things. And that actually brings us to the next question. Should I invest my emergency fund or keep it as cash? This question is one that I see a lot right now, particularly with all the fears around inflation. And yes, because of that very reason, because inflation is a certainty, it's just to what degree we'll see it. You should invest your cash rather than sitting on it as savings. But and it's a big butt, a Kim Kardashian size of a butt. You have to hold this with context and caution. Like I mentioned before, some emergencies are also coupled with a downturn in the market. So not only do you end up in a situation where you need your emergency fund, but you also end up in a situation where your emergency fund is just worth less. Not an ideal scenario. So if you're all caught up in your revolving debts, and if you have other credit facilities available to you, like unsecured lines of credit, or more ideal, like the home equity line of credit that we've already talked about, then you at least have some breathing room in the event that something happens that doesn't require you to liquidate your investments. If that's the case, then yeah, use your emergency fund and invest it wisely. In fact, you may even be able to use that capital to make your emergency fund even larger.